Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 53. Bathed in Blood. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Andy Clemence, Patrick Bussink, Tracy Lynn Olivera, James Konicek, Christopher Graybill, James Lewis, Joel Santner, Terence Aselford, Laura C. Harris, Michael Glenn, Tim Getman, Joe Brack, and Yasmin Tuazon.
Zajca Castle, Upper Hungary, December 30th, 1610. The castle door stood partially open, as if in invitation. From his hiding place amid the shrubbery half a dozen yards away, Count Georgi Torzo eyed the door cautiously. He didn't like it. He had planned every detail of this mission. Failure could not only doom his career, but bring reprisals the like of which he'd never seen. Torzo informed no one of his intent to visit the castle. The king merely ordered he investigate the accusations, a task he could have assigned to one of his own court functionaries. But Torzo decided to investigate himself. If the claims proved unfounded, he would call favor with the Countess, the widow of his old friend, for having saved her from public embarrassment. If the accusations proved true, well, he would be in position to handle the situation with the delicate hand required. He and his men traveled from the capital only at night, hiding out in abandoned barns and empty groves each morning, so that none might see their approach and send word ahead to the castle's mistress, Countess Elizabeth Bathory. The success of their venture depended entirely on surprise. The Countess might not be cut from the same cloth as her deceased husband, Ferenc Nadojdi, a man whose ruthless ferocity on the battlefield earned him the moniker the Black Knight of Hungary. But Torzo knew her to be extraordinarily intelligent and cunning, a combination apt to make her dangerous. His group reached the castle of Zajca just before sundown and hid in a narrow ravine half a mile outside of town until full dark. Then and only then, they passed through town and headed up the narrow road that led to the castle proper, sitting atop a hill overlooking both the town and the surrounding territory. Nearing the castle, they dismounted before the final bend in the road, tied the horses to nearby trees, and crept forward to their present position, a clump of shrubbery that allowed them to see the castle without being seen. That door looked like trouble to Torzo. He hadn't come all this way to be ambushed. Why leave it open? Torzo watched the entryway carefully, his gaze returning again and again to the narrow triangle of light spilling across the floor tiles just beyond. If someone waited inside the door, they would eventually shift their position. Their shadow would dance across that space, even if only for a second. But the light on the floor remained steady. No shadow disturbed it, even after waiting several long, tense moments. Not an ambush, then? A careless servant, perhaps? If so, they were in luck. Before setting out for Zajca, Torzo didn't know how he would gain access to the castle. He ran through various scenarios, but each, aside from scaling the walls, required help from someone inside. He had his men pack grappling hooks and ropes just in case, but he spent the better part of the journey here praying for another solution. The open door seemed an answer to his prayers. He glanced back at his men and gave the signal. Torzo headed for the half-open door at a brisk walk, drawing his sword as he went. He heard more than one blade slide from its sheath behind him and smiled at the sound. The men following at his heels were some of the best in his retinue and the most trustworthy. They'd been sworn to secrecy for the duration of the mission. Torzo didn't stop when he reached the door, but strode in, an excuse about his concern for the Countess's safety ready on his lips. The excuse turned out to be unnecessary, though, for the foyer was empty and much too quiet. Torzo waved his men forward. Perhaps it was just a misperception caused by his own unease, but every single man that followed him inside seemed to hesitate, as if aware that crossing the threshold put them on a path of no return. Real or imagined, Torzo didn't blame them. What they'd come here to investigate would chill even the most hardened of hearts. And if it was true...
If it is true, then God help us all.
The men quickly split into two groups. The first would sweep the upper floors, while the second, led by Torzo, would cover the main floor, then descend into the dungeons. If the rumors were true, he expected to find Elizabeth there. Word reached the king a week hence she would gather tonight with her confidants for one of her dark rituals. Torzo came to catch her in the act.
Better me than someone else. At least I will show restraint.
They found the first body less than 5 minutes after separating from the others. The young woman sprawled face down against the side of the passageway. She lay naked, her long blonde hair caked with drying blood. A thin, wavering trail of the same stretched out behind her, as if she had crawled forward on her stomach before her strength gave out. Torzo went to her side. He rolled her over and saw he was too late. The woman's unseeing eyes stared up at him. He noted, absently, she'd probably been quite pretty. But his true attention focused on the pallor of her skin, the multiple wounds covering her chest and abdomen. He stopped counting at 20. The sheer violence of the act sickened him. Who would do this to a woman? He knew the answer. He did not want to admit it.
Elizabeth, what have you done?
At first, Torzo thought the perpetrator used a knife or dagger, but upon closer examination he could see the wounds were rounded, like those delivered with an auger or some other tool designed for puncturing. They were also deep, and no doubt led to significant blood loss. That alone made him think she hadn't crawled here on her own. Someone dragged her and dumped her here when they had no more use for her.
After they drained her dry...
He shook the vile thought from his head and rose from the body, knowing this wouldn't be the last corpse they would find within these walls.
Nothing we can do for her. We'll take care of the body once we've secured the Countess. Let's keep moving.
The group continued deeper into the castle. The halls were well lit, but eerily empty, and the strange silence lay about the place like a shroud. Torzo was familiar with the general layout, one of the reasons for his selection to lead the fact-finding expedition. He had been friends with Nadojdi, Bathory's deceased husband, and often played within the castle walls as a child. He used that knowledge to lead his squad through the various rooms that made up the lower floor with relative quickness until they neared the stairs that led to the dungeons. There, they found a second body. It was another woman, though slightly older than the first. She too lay naked, with blood drying in her dark hair. Her torso showed the same brutal puncture wounds, her skin the same pallor, indicating massive blood loss. And she, too, was beautiful. Torzo could sense his men's mood changing from apprehension and fear to anger. It was one thing to accidentally kill a woman in the hot blood of battle, quite another to ruthlessly murder a woman in one's home. The noble class was not known for its gentle manner toward commoners, but this was obscene. Torzo rose to his feet, intending to speak to his men. Just then, the door to the dungeons proper, a few feet away, was shoved open. He spun around, sword at the ready, to find himself staring at two older women dressed in dark garments. They carried an injured, bloody girl between them. The two groups stared at each other for a long second, both perplexed at the interruption. Torzo recovered first. He stepped forward and pushed the point of his sword against the throat of the woman on the left, a woman he recognized as Dorotia Shemtis, one of Elizabeth's personal servants.
Put her down, gently.
For a moment, he thought Shemtis might actually try to argue. She glared at him, pretending to dismiss the blade at her throat. but a glance over his shoulder at the rest of his party, all heavily armed and no doubt as angry as he, must have convinced her. Without a word, she lowered the injured girl toward the floor, and her companion followed suit. Torzo kept his blade on Shemti's throat.
Bakash, Kolar, help that young woman. Sabo, keep your eye on her.
He indicated Shemtis's companion with a nod of his head.
While I talk to this one.
While his men did as ordered, Torzo used the point of his sword to nudge his captive off to one side, where they could talk in private.
Where is she?
Shemtis didn't bat an eyelash as she lied through her teeth.
At her estate in Vienna. She'll be there for a fortnight.
Torzo knew that wasn't true. He'd had men watching Bathory's other estates for 3 days. He knew she hadn't left Secha. He looked to Kolar, who shook his head. 3 victims. God help them.
If Lady Bathory is out of the country, then I suppose this was all your doing.
Bathory's servant was smart enough to see the trap he'd laid for her. Admitting to a capital offense would mean she was as good as dead. But she surprised him by nodding in agreement.
Yes, the girl's death is my fault.
He didn't believe that for a moment, but he also realized the futility of trying to get information out of her when she was all too willing to confess to murder. Anything she said would be suspect, and all of it more than likely designed to delay him from carrying out his real objective, locating and arresting the Countess.
I don't have time for this.
Torzo grabbed the woman by the arm and led her back to Sabo, who was keeping an eye on her companions.
Put them in irons. We're taking them both back to Bratislava to stand trial.
The soldier nodded and moved on the woman. Shemtis glared at him, but he ignored her. His thoughts on who he'd take with him into the dungeon for Elizabeth's arrest, and who he would leave behind to guard the prisoners. He never got the chance to make a decision. Torzo didn't hesitate. Gripping his sword, he rushed down the steps. 3 of his men followed. Torches burned in sconces set into the walls, lighting the way before them, and the group of men quickly found themselves standing in a narrow passageway with rows of cells on either side. The cells were full of women. Some held the living, some held the dead. Some held a mix of the two, and it was often difficult to tell the difference given their terrible state. One glance was all it took to see the women had been tortured, beaten, battered, and in some cases bitten, though by whom or what Torzo didn't know. Unlike the women they'd found upstairs, some of these prisoners needed immediate assistance. He couldn't just pass them by without giving aid. Leaving the dead to fulfill their mission was one thing. Abandoning the living was something else entirely. Thankfully, the doors to each cell were made of wood rather than iron. That meant there'd be no need to wait for a blacksmith. Torzo had anticipated the need to smash through a few doors once they were inside the castle, so several of his men were carrying battle hammers.
Break them down! Break them all down! Get these women upstairs and get them what aid you can!
His men immediately got to work, the wood resisting at first, and then splintering beneath repeated blows. The noise drew the other half of his party from the halls and chambers upstairs, where they'd been searching for the Countess.
Oh, thank you so much!
Soon, his men were entering the cells, leading those who could move up the stairs and into the great hall, where they received as much care as Torzo's men could provide. Those too injured to walk were carried upstairs by one or more of his soldiers. The gentleness these hardened warriors showed to the wounded struck Torzo deep in the heart. When the last of the prisoners reached the upper level, Torzo's men brought the bodies out of the cells and lined up in the passageway. Torzo stopped counting at 43. He'd checked the first few corpses, noting the same kinds of injuries they discovered upstairs. They'd been bled dry like animals brought to the butchers for slaughter. Torzo stood back and let his men work, his mind wandering to all but forgotten days, trying to figure out just where the Countess was hiding. The upper floors were vacant, and they searched every inch of the lower floors as well. Lady Bathory had been inside these walls when the night began, and Shemtis's behavior seemed to indicate she was still here somewhere. He cast his thoughts back to the days when he and Terence had run wild through these tunnels, and as the images rushed through his mind, one stuck out. A faint memory of Terence showing him a hidden door in one of the cells, a door that led to an unfinished tunnel. Torzo slipped away from the others and entered the cell in question. Holding a torch, he walked over to the back wall. Torzo pressed on it several times, trying to remember how his childhood friend had done it all those years ago. Something about putting pressure on the right slab while standing just so. The wall slid open, revealing the passage he remembered from his youth. At that time, the tunnel had led to a dead end, but he could see now that improvements had been made over the years, widening the tunnel, lengthening it. Lit torches hung on the walls at regular intervals. The tunnel took a couple of sharp turns, then opened up into a wide chamber. In the center of the room, a large rectangular sunken bath was surrounded by half a dozen braziers. Each had a fire blazing inside, no doubt to help ward off the room's chill. In the flame's lurid light, the bathwater had an unusual crimson tint. Torzo stepped forward, moving closer, and as he did so, the smell finally hit him. A thick, coppery scent, one intimately familiar to him, the scent of every battlefield. With slowly dawning horror, Torzo realized the bath held no water. It held blood, a vast pool of blood hot enough to give off steam. He'd never seen anything like it. And while he stood there, the surface of the pool suddenly rippled and a figure rose out of its depths, shocking him so much that he stumbled backward.
What's the matter, Girgi? Surely you've seen a naked woman before.
Elizabeth.
He stood there staring. He couldn't help himself. The Countess stood thigh deep in the tub, the fluid slowly sliding down her curves and back into the bath, allowing her pale skin to peek out from the crimson flow. Her usually raven black hair was highlighted with streaks of color. Her blue eyes peered out of a face that seemed camouflaged in red paint. She licked her lips, reminding him it wasn't paint at all, but blood. Human blood.
My God, Elizabeth. What have you done?
What have I done? I found the very thing man has spent centuries searching for. The very thing he thought forever out of reach. I found the secret to immortality.
Immortality? You're insane. Look at yourself, Elizabeth. You're covered in blood, for heaven's sake.
Yes, look at me, Girgi. Look at me.
She spread her arms to draw attention to her body.
I'm 50 years old and I look like a girl of 25. I'm getting younger with every treatment.
Torzo looked. As morbid as the scene was, he couldn't take his gaze off her. He told himself he was looking for evidence to back up her claims, preposterous as they were, but deep down he knew the truth. Countess Elizabeth Bathory was a beauty, even as she appeared now. Torzo couldn't deny that. He'd found her attractive when they were younger, when she'd been betrothed to his friend, and the years had only done her justice. He looked because he wanted to look, as simple as that. Rounded wounds, like those caused by a pike or an auger. The thought slipped in like an enemy from the shadows, reminding him of just how the Countess and her companions obtained all the blood currently steaming in the sunken bath. Torzo turned, suddenly ashamed. He focused his gaze just beyond her so he could see her movements but wouldn't be so tempted to stare. Torzo tried to figure out just how many bodies it must take to fill a tub of that size. She had mentioned multiple treatments.
I don't care what you claim to have discovered.
He waved with his free hand at the bath before him.
You should be struck down where you stand for this... abomination.
Elizabeth walked forward slowly, swaying slightly, as if listening to some sensual rhythm only she could hear. Torzo tried to keep his gaze focused over her shoulder, but the closer she came, the more difficult that was, until he had no choice but to face her. By now, she had moved only a few feet away. His gaze found hers, and then, as if by its own volition, dropped to her body once more. Catching himself, he looked back into her face and saw her smirking at him.
Oh, but you're not going to do that, are you, Girgi? There are other things you'd much rather do than strike me down.
She was right. He could no more hurt her than he could grow wings and fly. He'd loved Elizabeth Bathory for years. Elizabeth moved closer until her blood-slicked body was just inches from his own. He could feel her heat.
So what are you going to do, Girgi?
Torzo stared deep into her eyes, letting her see the storm raging within him.
In the name of His Majesty, King Matias II, and under the authority granted to me as Palatine of Hungary, I place you under arrest for the torture and murder of multiple young women under your care.
Bicha, Hungary, January 1611. The trial was a madhouse. Torzo watched the proceedings from the balcony overlooking the judge's box for several days. He watched witness after witness take the stand and condemn the three women and one man on trial for the evils conducted at Secha and elsewhere. Elizabeth herself did not stand for trial. She remained at Secha Castle under house arrest, guarded by 10 of Torzo's most trusted men. It took considerable effort on his part to convince King Matias that putting a member of the upper nobility on trial would serve little purpose. Bathory came from a wealthy and influential family. Angering them by trying and executing her would have caused no end of difficulties. Torzo hoped to convince the king Elizabeth should be spirited away to a nunnery for the remainder of her days. That possibility grew less and less likely as word of Bathory's involvement in the atrocities quickly spread. Just the day before, one of the maids produced a journal as evidence, listing 650 victims who died by Elizabeth's hand. Torzo hadn't seen it himself. He couldn't vouch for its authenticity, but at this point it didn't matter. Elizabeth was responsible for killing young women and stealing their blood. Torzo witnessed her crimes firsthand. Commotion spread through the courtroom below, breaking into Torzo's thoughts. Leaning over the banister, he could see that Royal Supreme Court Judge Theodosius Shirmienshish was returning to his seat while his 20 co-judges took their place in the judge's box. Torzo felt his pulse race. A verdict must have been reached. Judge Shirmienshish sat down and waited. When all grew quiet, he faced the defendants.
Dorotya Shemtis, Ilona Yo, Katarina Benitska, and Janos Fitzko. This court finds you guilty of 80 counts of murder. Defendants Shemtis, Yo, and Fitzko shall be put to death, sentenced to be carried out immediately. Defendant Benitska is sentenced to life imprisonment. The court has spoken.
Commotion erupted again, but Torzo had lost interest. The verdict was exactly what he'd predicted. Benitska had been bullied by the others and therefore deserved a lesser sentence, an opinion he stressed during his own testimony a few days earlier. Justice had been served. A memory of Elizabeth rising out of the pool of blood reminded him that one aspect of this affair still needed resolution. Thankfully, the verdict would give him the opportunity to see the king and plead his case again. Perhaps this time, the king might listen. 40 minutes later, he was ushered into the king's meeting chamber, where he found Elizabeth's eldest son, Paul, already in conference with His Majesty. The king looked up at his approach.
Ah, welcome, Torzo. How goes the trial?
The judge returned a guilty verdict less than an hour ago. The three sentenced to death have little time left in this world.
And thank God for that. A nasty business all around.
Torzo glanced at Paul, but the other man wouldn't meet his eye. A tremor of concern shook Torzo. Had Paul negotiated with the king behind his back? Torzo suspected he had, and the king's next words confirmed it.
Young Bathory has a rather unique answer to our other problem.
Is that so?
Torzo glanced at Paul one last time before giving his full attention to the king.
You made it clear that a public trial and execution of Countess Bathory would be a mistake.
Yes, I have, and...
The king held up a hand, silencing him.
I happen to agree with you, as does the Countess's heir.
This time, Paul met Torzo's gaze and nodded briefly before looking away again.
We cannot, however, allow the Countess's monstrous actions to continue.
Here it comes.
I have agreed to grant Countess Bathory my pardon and absolution for the crime she has committed against my subjects. In return, Her son will consider my debt to the Bathory family repaid in full.
Tuazon knew the family loaned the king considerable amounts over the past several years, but Countess Bathory controlled that debt, not Paul. And she would continue to control it until her death. Then, and only then, would control pass to her son. The king wasn't finished, however.
Paul agrees that the Countess must pay for her crimes. It is only just. To that end, he has suggested that she be imprisoned within her suite of rooms inside Secha Castle, there to remain until she passes from this earth. Since she would be unable to carry out the myriad duties her position as head of the Bathory family requires, I would have no choice but to declare her legally dead and pass control of her estates to her heir.
Matias and young Bathory smiled at each other, and Tuazon knew in that moment it was already decided. The king wanted his debt excused, and Elizabeth's son wanted her out of the way. The solution was elegant and simple. Everybody would win, except Elizabeth.
At least she'll be alive.
Tuazon mustered a smile.
An elegant solution, sire.
Good. I'm putting you in charge of the masonry work.
Masonry?
Yes, of course. Did you think we would just guard the door?
That was exactly what Tuazon pictured. Post a guard, allow her to spend some time in the fresh air every day. The civilized approach. But too late, Tuazon remembered Matias harbored a cruel streak. He now took revenge on the Countess for holding the debt over his head.
I want the entire suite of rooms bricked up. Doors, windows, everything. We'll leave a few slots in the walls through which she can receive her food, and so the guards can keep an eye on her. She will remain a prisoner, a real prisoner, until the day her vile countenance passes from this earth. Do you understand, Tuazon?
He nodded and waited for the king to dismiss him with a toss of his head. As he moved toward the exit, one final question occurred to him.
If I may, Your Majesty, why me?
The king didn't even look at him as he delivered his answer.
You should have killed her when you had the chance, Tuazon, and saved me all this nonsense. Since you didn't, I'm leaving it in your hands.
In trying to save her life, Tuazon delivered her a fate worse than death. Love, truly, was blind. Secha Castle, Slovakia. Present day. Annja Creed eyed the camera for a moment and then stepped forward to adjust the angle of the lens an inch or so to the left. Satisfied, she nodded to herself, moved back to her former position, and keyed the remote in her left hand.
As you can see, behind me lies the ruins of Secha Castle, home to one of the most beautiful and most villainous women to walk the planet, the Blood Countess herself, Elizabeth Bathory.
A shake of her head, a double click of the remote to stop and restart the recording, and then she tried again.
The crumbling walls you see behind me are the ruins of Secha Castle, once home to Elizabeth Bathory, a woman some consider one of history's greatest
Gah! She stopped the recording and turned away in frustration. Creating the opening to the show should have been a piece of cake. She'd done hundreds of such takes during her time as co-host of the cable television show Chasing History's Monsters. Yes, normally she would have worked with a cameraman and wouldn't have to worry about framing and proper exposure, but she was a steady hand at this by now, and probably could have shot, edited, and produced the entire show on her own. Exactly what she intended to do for this one. The whole thing was a bit of a lark for her. She'd been with her regular crew in the Czech Republic, filming an episode on Faust and the mysterious creature still supposedly haunting his house. When the shoot finished early, Annja found herself with a few extra days. She decided to make the jaunt across the border into Slovakia to do some rock climbing and maybe even Bathory's legendary castle. She caught a flight into Bratislava, took a train northeast into Košice, and drove the short distance to the small village of Višnjova. Annja could see the castle's ruins on the hill above the village as she drove in. That was when the idea struck. She checked into her hotel, fired up her laptop, and searched the database. For some strange reason, Chasing History's Monsters had never done an episode on the world's most notorious serial killer, Countess Bathory herself.
Don't look a gift horse in the mouth, Annja.
Selling a complete episode, shot, cut, and edited, to her producer, Doug Morrell, would net her some extra cash and give him an episode he could deliver to his own bosses seemingly overnight. That would make him look good, and he could even hold on to it for an emergency situation when some other episode's filming went south. It was a win-win situation. If she could get the opening right. Annja turned and surveyed the ruin of the castle. There really wasn't much to look at, truth be told. A few sets of crumbling walls, an extended tower or two, not much more than that. Ferenc II, Rákóczi, sacked and plundered the castle in 1708 as part of the Hungarian uprising against the Habsburgs. He left it to fall into ruin. Time and the elements did their patient, inexorable work. And yet, something still drew people here. She knew what it was, the lure of history, and in this case, enticement of the Blood Countess. The idea of standing among the same stones where the notorious serial killer once lived held a kind of eerie fascination for many people. The fact it happened back in the 1600s didn't make any difference. As with Vlad Dracul, the Wallachian prince who was generally recognized as the inspiration for Bram Stoker's Dracula, the legend of Elizabeth Báthory grew over the ages. However, Annja wanted to expose the history behind it all. Doug would prefer her to ignore the high road and feature reenactments of the beautiful Báthory climbing naked out of a pool of blood. No. If she was going to do a show about Báthory, she was going to tell the truth. Or at least as much of the truth as she could find. Annja stepped to the edge of the escarpment and looked out across the forested hills and rocky crags. The late afternoon sun lit everything with a patina of gold as it sank toward the horizon. She imagined the Countess doing the same thing many times. With her own deeply tanned skin, long auburn hair, and ambergreen eyes, there was little chance of anyone mistaking Annja for the pale, dark-haired woman who had terrorized this land for more than two decades. And it was doubtful that the Countess Báthory had ever worn a New York Yankees baseball cap. Annja reached up and adjusted the brim to keep the sun out of her eyes. It was a nice day, warm and clear. She could see for miles. It would get colder later that night, but for now she stood perfectly comfortable in her long-sleeved shirt, shorts, and hiking boots, her usual dig attire. Fans of the show expected to see her outfitted in the same. She didn't mind. It was what she would have worn anyway, show or not. As she turned away from the overlook, she reviewed what she knew about the Countess. Báthory had been born in Hungary in 1560. Both an uncle on her father's side and her maternal grandfather had been princes of Transylvania. She was also cousin to Stefan Báthory, the King of Poland and Duke of Transylvania. Elizabeth grew up on the family estate in Nyírbátor and taught to speak multiple languages, including Hungarian, Latin, and Greek. By all evidence, an extremely intelligent woman. Engaged to Ferenc Nádasdy, a Hungarian nobleman, at age 12, Elizabeth became pregnant after an affair with one of the palace servants the following year. She gave birth in secret, but not before Nádasdy had the servant castrated and thrown to the dogs. The child, a daughter, was quickly disowned, and Ferenc and Elizabeth married in May of 1575, when she was 14 and a half years old. His wedding gift to his young bride was Secha Castle and the territory surrounding it. 14 and a half? Annja couldn't imagine getting married now, in her mid-20s, never mind a decade or so ago. She knew it was the custom of the time, but that didn't make it any easier to swallow, especially given what happened next. In 1578, Báthory's husband...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.